Good afternoon. Well, let's start. Today, I would like to share with you the multi-cloud machine learning data workflow with Kubernetes. First, I want to introduce ourselves. This is Xue from Momenta. He is the one responsible for the Momenta infrastructure. He contributes a lot to the open source. For example, he's the contributor of the Kubeflow, as well as the creator of the Kubeflow Kubernetes tool. He also contributes a lot to others. His interest is in front of the data learning as well as the storage. My name is Xue Fei. I worked in the Google before, and I was one of the early members of the Google Kubeflow team. But currently, I work in a large scale internet finance company. I work as the product manager. My interest in the large scale deep learning and the distributed machine learning, and his name is Xue Lei, and my name is Xue Fei, but actually we are not twins. And Momenta is a sub-team of the Unicorn, an auto-driving company. Their team is really powerful for the visual running. For example, they also have a team member who creates the really famous software. They would like to use the cameras for visualization, detection, and tracking. So they don't pay attention to the sensor, but they pay attention to the visual. And because of these kind of features, there are some impacts on the Momenta infrastructure. Well, actually, these kind of impacts will be covered in our presentation. We may talk about two things: why Kubernetes for machine learning in the multi-cloud environment. So first one, why Kubernetes for machine learning? There are three main reasons which you are really familiar with. We think that Kubernetes is really portable, and Kubernetes can have the scalable machine learning, and it can have some isolation for that workflow as well. So all these are advantages of the Kubernetes. And there are some other special things of the Momenta. The infrastructure of the Momenta is realized the multi-cloud setup. So this is the evolution of the Momenta in the 2016 when company was founded. The Momenta builds their own data center. Currently, in the south part and the north part of China, we have our own data center respectively, because this kind of the data center can be used for the high performance machine learning. And all these kind of the things are really customized. For example, we have the customized GPU and customized the network setting. But from 2016 to now, some companies of the cloud has already provide some infrastructures for machine learning. And this kind of the infrastructure has already been developed so fast. For example, the Ali cloud and all this kind of the infrastructure has already been available on the cloud. And if we don't have enough resources in the data center, we also use some on-cloud GPU and other services which is available on the cloud. And I just tell you that why we use the Kubernetes for the multi-cloud machine learning. We know that Kubernetes has already been available for 4 years, but maybe it doesn't have a really complete solution for the machine learning. When we do the multi-cloud machine learning, there are three main problems. The first one is that if we have more than one data center, we have more regions on the cloud. And how can we manage the data for training that used for the machine learning, and how we should configure all these kind of the data? And all these kind of the challenges will be covered in details. And the first one is the data management, and the second one, and some of the speakers has already mentioned, and on the Kubernetes, how can we schedule the workflow? Because the schedule for machine learning has their own features which cannot be supported by the Kubernetes completely. So how can we tackle that problem? And another one is that, such as the Mr. Che Yang from Alibaba just mentioned, that there are some heterogeneous hardware such as EDS and EMA, etc. And we also met some problems in these aspects as well. And now my co-worker shall I just share with you about the data management. And now I will be responsible for introducing the data management for you. In machine learning, data is really important. And in our output model, for example, the face ID we recognize, it needs the accumulation of data so that it can be precise for the available multi-cloud or heterogeneous computing cloud mix. How can we synchronize or backup or copy all this kind of the data on different terminals, on different clouds? And this is a pain point for us. And we just mentioned that what we did was based on the visual. Visual is our key. We would like to rely on the visual to tackle the problems of the detection. Regarding to the visual, we would like to associate with the diagram or the shapes, and all these kind of pictures we use is from 16 gigabytes to 5 megabytes. And we have lots of the documents like this, more than one or several hundred millions. So how can we import all these kind of the documents to the GPU and allow the GPU to use this kind of the document for computing and for the training? Which is quite key for us. And if we use the site or MS, as a storage terminal for the Kubernetes, we would like to use it to set all the set of the training and then use it for machine learning. It sounds quite simple, but in reality, when we train machine, when we use this data, there is a problem. This kind of, we have a lot of the distributed documents. Whether it can solve the reading, whether it can have a really good reading speed or not, and in order to have a really good performance, what we can do to help that. Another thing is that it is in the switch repo. When we customize the AI, it's even more difficult because our rule is that we don't want to change the core code of the Kubernetes, because if we do and then we combine that, the process would be really painful. Therefore, the current solution cannot solve the problems we have. Any other ways for us to tackle the challenges we encounter? From the lower left corner of this diagram, we can see that we use the object distributed system to store data, and all these kind of data are the training data, and by using the CFS, the data in the object storage will be exposed to the TensorFlow and Cafe and other training programs, a training framework in the container, so that the CPU can use all these data really fast. Some of you may ask that for the document system and the objective system, which one is better? Well, actually, document system is really simple. They can use a really simple instruction to see all the content, but it also has its own disadvantage. For example, it involves the problem such as authentication, changing time and end time, etc. So it will introduce more data which are not important to us, so that's why we choose the objective storage, and it uses the data cluster to accelerate the reading speed. So we use the and this one is not introduced very often on the Kubernetes. Why it is really valuable to us? Because it is highly customized. Why? It has two things. You can see it from this diagram. And this is the CSI architecture of the Kubernetes. We don't talk about the binding process of the CSI in the world. So let's have a look at the upper right corner. In the plugin, we have the chase system. Cache system, and it's kind of the cache system. It is the multi-level one. It is multi-level one means that it has the memory cache, P2P cache, and the service cache. And for the multiple machine, it means the P2P cache in one training task, and with more machines, this kind of the P2P cache can accelerate the data reading. And on the lower part, we support the OS of the Ali Cloud OS 3 as well as the object storage. And in on the cloud, we can use some really simple objective storage, for example, OSS for the Ali Cloud. But on the offline, we can only have our own storage. So in the CSI, we can use the objective storage to the documents interface, which can be easily used by the users. And this kind of the socket is SASU. It is the user-based. And in this space, when I train, well, actually, a training scenario will have a data set. It will be read completely and processed completely and get a result. When there is a cache, which means that when we read the data for the first time, the data will be read from the objective storage from the backstage and then stored in the cache. And in this way, when we read it later, we can read it faster. And later, I would like to introduce you fields. And I would like to skip the working theory of the fields because it's not related to the topic. And it is an interface for the user space program to export a live system to the Linux kernel. By using this one, we can realize the data transfer, data conversion, and data communication. So when we read a document from the application to the VFS and to the DB and then to the fields back again, the advantage is that it can reduce the cost of developing a document system. And when we develop a document system, we do it in a kernel. But if we would like to reduce the difficulty, we do it in the user's interface. And another one is the caps. I think that the precision is really important in the scenarios with the AI or according to the requirements of the AI. We define the substitutional policy of the caps. In the past, we have the random LRO. But for the AI and the AI-related scenarios, the data set it is only readable. We cannot change the data. And all these kind of data will be processed repeatedly in the GPU. So whether we can for these three substitutional policies, we know whether they are the best. Well, actually, our result tells me no, because the cache precision is changed. It is not stable. The value is not stable. Therefore, the CPU just substitute the CPU and do the memory coding, etc. In this way, it will increase the burdens of the resource because the resource is really valuable. So that's why we use the NR node replacement. The policy is really simple.
So the policy is simple. We don't just read once and decide that it won't be replaced. Just read it and store it. And for Apple, the data set will be read and to process for each Apple. So the not replacement will keep the hit ratio for each Apple. So on this table, you can see the size of memory and corresponding policy. With the NR policy, we can the data, the value can be maintained more stably. And this data set is about 160 GB over 1.2 million images. This is the performance realized. So now let's see some issues in the workflow app application just now. The
operator
has elaborated on the ML operator and the progress. Now I would like to share our usage. So operator use Kubernetes to do the distributed training. This way we don't need to manage its underlying infrastructure like a private server or
other
Kubeflow includes all these operators like Mr. Xue. Mr. Xue is a major contributor in terms of deep learning. We can think about the distributed learning. It has different levels. The first, the simplest one, the first level would be from server, meaning that we have multiple machines that have CPU. Then we can pick one machine to serve the parameter, and the rest of the machines will do the learning. And this approach can cover each machine and server, when there are multiple machines and multiple machine cards, then parameter server will have bottlenecks. Because if you only have one parameter server, but you have a big model, then the parameter server will become a bottleneck on the internet. Then to do so, usually we use the high performing computing or the MPI operator, but this MPI operator, it doesn't require
ring out reduce 的方法，也就是只发
it uses the ring out reduce，就在晚上所有的机器，meaning that you can send the parameter once, then you can run on the on these machines, then there will be no bottleneck.
And for the Kubeflow, you can see,
and MPR is an approach to deal with it.
另外一个在这个 workflow orchestration 上遇到的一个问题就是
we also have, met some issues because now we are now in a multi-cloud environment. That means for each cloud, each cloud or each IDC, it itself can be a cluster.
Now,
how can we manage these multiple clusters? How can we assign each job for which cluster? This is an upper level concept for Kubernetes.
Kubernetes.
And
from
Momenta, we have this cluster manager. And this control manager will communicate directly with the RoCE.
And
this RoCE will specify your job. For example, you can specify the data center in Beijing or in the region in the cloud. So, the controller manager will do the deployment. The controller manager is to centralize or put together the resources or information across the clusters, then users can design the direction which way to go. Later, I will show you in the demo. And another common issue is in the multiple machine and the multiple cars. But for a single machine or single car, you just need one port. But let's say you need 16 cards, but usually a machine has 8 cards only. And if you require 16 cards, that means multiple pods, then there can be an issue. For example, there are two people in the Momenta. One is an intern, the other is a researcher. Both of them need 16 cards, but now there are only two machines left with 16 cards. When two people schedule the resource at the same time, they both claim that their job already gets the 8 cards from one machine. That becomes a pod, and they are waiting for the remaining 8 cards to be released, and this will become a deadlock. And Kubernetes couldn't provide its positive support in this regard. Then there is a scheduler, the concept called a Gantt scheduler. Gantt scheduler means that when there is a number of pods, we can treat them as a group. Then we can schedule these group of pods at the same time. This will help us to adjust the deadlock. And we can use the queue batch to adjust part of the issue. But actually for Momenta, the solution is that it uses part of the queue back logic, and it also adds the priority scheduling, this concept. Like the case of intern and the researcher, then we couldn't have intern to replace the researcher. So each one, there is a priority when it comes to their jobs. So this logic applies to this resource scheduling. On Monday, it has been mentioned that the Kubernetes community is now adding the priority orchestration and priority scheduling, such concept. But the levels or hierarchies are different. So in Kubernetes, the priority is for a single pod, but the priority scheduling or orchestration we are talking about is targeted to the group of pods. Just want to clarify that.
No?
After it is done, and let's say the intern has less, intern's job is less, it's not as important, or like the researcher's job has more priority compared to intern's job, then the intern's job will be put behind. Then the researcher's job can carry out its work first, and after it completed its job, then the intern can submit this and pick up his job, and this won't waste too much time or energy. This can also guarantee better resource utilization. So these are the challenges for workflow orchestration. Now I would like to talk about the issues for heterogeneous hardware. Like Michael heard that explain their work on this heterogeneous hardware. You may think about GPU, that's just one part of it. But actually, there are some challenges like RDMA. RDMA plugin is an important component as well. The training bottleneck may come from different aspects.
Like some more, the computing capacity.
But this can be adjusted with better computing performance. The bottlenecks may come from I/O or network as well. If your I/O or network couldn't catch up, then it can be a waste.
So
we have different solutions on cloud or IDC to prevent this issue. For example, on this slide,
on-prem,
a better solution is to use RDMA. RDMA itself is a different protocol to lower your network latency so that the data
can be communicated
from node to node. Then for the next round of training, there won't be too much waiting time. And Google issued the TPU.
TPU
is computing may be different from GPUs.
But
when you have 8 TPU linked,
and
the TPU pod has a specialized network. It's a very high performing network. Because of this network, these 8 TPU linked perform much better or higher than the GPU. But if we compare a single TPU and the GPU, then there is much difference. For the cloud, different cloud vendors are now working on the network efficiency in order to do deep learning or machine learning. So Ethernet, they also have a solution which is not available in the Chinese market yet. As I said, network has could impact the training.
This
diagram
gives
you a demonstration about the possible impact. There are three scenarios. One is you use RDMA, the other use TCP, another one use IDU. Or ideal scenario, meaning like if your network is fast enough, when your TPU's number grows, then your image processed in each second per second should grow in linear way. So we can see that when the network is better, the training speed is faster and the training result is more promising. So, network is another factor for you to consider. So now I would like to talk about RDMA. Actually, we use this RDMA device plugin. So I won't elaborate on that, but for RDMA, it is a high-performing network. On the top bottom right, you will see that for the TCP/IP, it's a long path, but the RDMA is short, and it encourages endpoint to endpoint memory writing, and it also reduces CPU consumption. So it is a widely applied protocol.
Okay, and this is our demo. Well, I already upload a task, and just imagine that I just create a script. This is the client on online, and it is the production system. We use it for a demo. So let's have a look at the queuing condition. If you like to refer to the log, you can do it to see the log and to see the logs, and you can see the progress. Besides that, we also want to focus that during the training, I would like to know the using rate, the usage rate of the GPU, so I can go into the container. You can see that the usage rate of the GPU is 90%, so I can tell that the communication framework or architecture is quite good, so that the using rate is quite high. And this one we use it in the Ali cloud. So let's have a look at the offline cluster. We call it Matrix. So let's have a look at the cluster called Matrix. It is running the cafe task. And this is the cafe task running by the Matrix. So let's see its performance. It is quite intuitive. In this way, the users doesn't need to store a lot of things. Everything can be used, can be stored on the cloud. And you can see the using rates, the overall using conditions, and the algorithm node as well. So let's see that what is the corresponding conditions. And this is the packaging. One, and it can save a lot of the stateful information and reduce the actions or behavior of the users. And this is the clustered. And this is the overall usage. And if I would like to cancel a task, I think that there is some problem regarding to the parameter or the precision of the training. I would like to cancel one task and I just do it. And the US is also the URM, and we can also use it to reduce the cost as well. And we just introduced that before. This is the Kubernetes architect at the Momentum. And on the right hand side is the objective storage, and it will expose to in the container for the user to use. In the container, we run the available data and other virtual framework, and then we will use different kind of the device to work as the heterogeneous hardware. We also have best ML operator, and all these are the components we use for development. So all these are the technologies of the Kubernetes we use in the AI scenarios. We would like to solve a lot of the problems regarding to the data workflow and the heterogeneous hardware. Well, any questions from the floor? Well, I also work on the platform development, so I will ask a lot of the detailed questions on the background US S3 and on the front end you use the fields, but actually we tried it before, there is a problem when the model is quite large. The writing speed is a problem in the S3. Well, actually the model writing, it is not dead in the fields. So the fields use it for reading only, right? Yes, that's right. So what would you like to do? For the algorithm engineer, it needs to tell you that where it reads the data, where it writes the data. Well, actually, all the homes will be available. So this kind of the home, it will be stored as the model, readable model and writable model. But for the reading data, they need to tell me the name of the data set. You can tell me where it can mount. But how about the data? How the data will be uploaded? Yes, the data will be uploaded. Well, actually, we need to upload the data. We'll have the data set. And the data set, it will have the subcommand, just like the cake. The data set can be uploaded to a specific name or a specific remote terminal so that we can manage that for you and synchronize to all the IDC. Well, let's ask more questions about the data set. When you do the IDC, you use the distributed one. Well, actually, everything will be copied. We have a lot of the copies. Because for the auto driving or using the AI in this scenario, data set has already reached the bottleneck, so it won't have a really obvious infringement. So what we need to do is to use the kernel case to optimize our model instead of starting a new model from the scratch. What if you would like to explore a model? Well, explore a new model. We would like to use the open dataset such as the COCO. So you will upload the data for the machine training or what? Yes, that's right. For this kind of the public or the general database, that has already been embedded. Well, actually, we can talk about that in private. There are a lot of the questions I would like to ask. Well, sorry, time is up. And if you are interested in our talks, please talk to us privately. Thank you very much for your listening.